Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Today is the first Sunday in Advent, and it's my prayer that this will be a season of amazing spiritual growth for each and every one of us. I pray our hearts will be set on fire for the gospel of Jesus Christ, that every day of our lives, Jesus is first and foremost in all that we do. That as we learned last week, Jesus is the cornerstone of our faith. This is also a great time of the year where we can invite friends and neighbors to church. So if there's someone on your heart this week that you've been wanting to share the love of Christ with, take that step of faith and invite them, talk with them, and share the good news of the gospel. For this is a season many people are open and receptive to hearing about Jesus. So many in our nation now don't know Jesus, and they need to hear the good news. It's so evident with all that's going on around us that so many don't know the Lord. So much in our land could be fixed if people would just turn their hearts to Jesus. So invite someone to church. It's a challenge. For Advent, I'll be doing a four-part series on Jesus. This week is Jesus, the steadfast love, as we just sang about. And next week, I'll be talking on Jesus, the shining light. The third week of Advent, Jesus, the saving lamb. And in week four of Advent, Jesus, the sovereign Lord. So you'll not want to miss a week of Advent this year as we discuss all those things about our Lord and Savior Jesus. So for those taking notes this morning, I'll have 3 points today regarding the steadfast love of Jesus. I could probably have 8 or 9, but time only allows me for 3. Probably 100. But God's love is infinite, so we could be here for a long time talking about Jesus' love. We first must understand that Jesus' steadfast love is selfless. Jesus' steadfast love is selfless. Church, do we fully understand what selfless love really is? The dictionary defines selfless as this: having little or no concern for oneself, especially with regard to fame, position, or money. Do you know anyone that fits this description? Well, the Bible tells us someone who does, and his name is Jesus. So turn with me now in your Bibles to John, chapter 13, verse 4. Book of John, chapter 13, verse 4. Here in the book of John, recorded that Jesus got up from the table. This is where he's washing the disciples' feet. It says that Jesus got up from the table. He took off his outer robe and tied a towel around himself. Jesus was doing this as he was going to wash his disciples' feet. Foot washing back in Jesus' day was a common practice. And typically, in an average home, the host would provide water for the guests, and they would pretty much wash their own feet. But in a wealthy home, this task was done by a slave or a servant. And it was considered one of the lowliest tasks of all that one could do, washing somebody's feet, washing dirty feet. So here's a picture of Jesus taking on the selfless role. The selfless role of a servant. Taking his robe off and putting on a towel to wash his disciples' feet. What does this have to do with Advent, you ask? Well, what Jesus did here with his disciples is just symbolic, really, of what Jesus did 2,000 years ago. Jesus Christ selflessly stepped out of the glory of heaven to come to a sinful earth in the form of a man, putting on skin and bones, but with a purpose to wash us clean of all our sins. The Bible says in Philippians 2, 5 through 8, so let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave. Jesus taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, Jesus humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. As it says in Philippians, did you hear that? Jesus, God in the flesh, took the form of a slave. He was not concerned about money, power, or his status. There was a story once of a man who was talking to his pastor at church one Sunday. This man said, you preachers talk a lot about giving, but when you get right down to it, it all comes down to basin theology. Pastor replied, basin theology? What is that? The man replied, remember what Pilate did when he had the chance to acquit Jesus? He called for a basin and basically just washed his hands of the whole thing. Jesus. Jesus, the night before his death, called for a basin and proceeded to wash his disciples' feet. It all comes down to basin theology. Which one will you use? Church, are we loving those around us with the same selfless love of Jesus? Many times we have heard or may hear a testimony of how God brought a person from nothing to something. And we give God praise and thanks for that because he does that. But let's never forget the fact that Jesus did something he didn't have to do. He came from something, heaven, to nothing, this sinful earth, leaving his throne in heaven to come here for us. He didn't have to do it. But he left his throne to become a servant. The Bible tells us in Luke 22, verses 24 through 27. And this is at the same time, just before Jesus washed their feet, that the disciples were arguing with each other about who was the greatest. Again, this happened just before Jesus was about to wash. Being like a servant. Selfless sacrifice. We must understand this, that true greatness comes through Christ. Like selflessness. Be sure to make this Advent season, friends, one that you will always remember. This is the year to have a memorable Advent season. We've had many of us here. But make this one extra special. The Lord's coming back soon. Amen. So make this year the season that you'll always remember. Make it a point to set aside some time to do something that you wouldn't ordinarily do. Do something, and it might be as simple as sending a note, writing a card, making a phone call to someone to let them know that you're thinking of them and that you love them. But it might be something difficult. It might be something very difficult. I don't know what that would be. Only you would know in your heart those difficult things that need to be done this season. But this Christmas season, let us be thankful for the steadfast, selfless love of Christ, but also to be able to model that in our own lives. Because Christ left his throne, and he came down to claim his own, you and me. Secondly, the steadfast love of Jesus is sanctifying. The steadfast love of Jesus is sanctifying. I know what you're saying here. Pastor, you're using one of those theological words again. just what does sanctifying mean? What does that have to do with Advent? The word sanctify, in its broadest terms, means to cleanse, to purify. But more literally, it means to be set apart, to be made clean, to be made holy and pure. And Jesus' steadfast love for us does just that. Jesus came to earth as a Savior, not just to wash our feet, which we must let him do, as Peter had to let him do, though he didn't want him to let him do it. Jesus came to earth to wash our dirty, sinful hearts. He came to make us clean, not just on the outside, but on the inside. To change our hearts and to clean our hearts. To sanctify us, to make us holy. Turn your Bibles to the Gospel of John, chapter 17, 17. Book of John, chapter 17, 17. Jesus is praying for us. And hearing John, he says, "Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. For your word is truth." From that verse, from that prayer, what should our response be? It should be a response of confession. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and righteous to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We should be crying out with the writer of Psalm 51:10. Psalm 51:10, the psalmist writes, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me." Church, are we, are you and I willing to let Jesus take over and be the Lord of your life today?
Yes.
In every area of your life, and let him change you from the inside out. Clean our hearts and minds. Let today be that day where we surrender all to Jesus. All to Jesus, and we freely give it. The Apostle Paul tells us in Ephesians 5, verses 25 through 26, that Jesus loves the church, and that's you and me, so much that he gave himself up for her in order to make her holy by the cleansing her with the washing of water by the word. Did you hear that? By the washing of water by the word. Not made clean by soap and hot water, but cleansed by the water in the word, by the word of God. The word of God, church, has power in it, that when we allow it to penetrate deep into our hearts and minds, it's like a refining fire. And what refining fires do is they purify. They take out the bad things and put in the good things. So the word of God is a refining fire. In ancient times, this form of refining gold involved a craftsman sitting next to a very hot fire with melted liquid gold in a large bowl. What they would do is stir it. And what would happen is all the impurities would rise to the top, and they would skim the impurities off the top. This molten metal resulted in a muddy-like substance that was cooled becomes pure gold. Church, that's what the Word of God is like. When you allow it to work in your life, when you allow it to sink into your heart, it cleans and it purifies. And when you have the Holy Spirit and the Word of God working in you, is anything impossible? No. So many times we limit ourselves thinking things are just too impossible for us. And as humans it is. But we have the Holy Spirit as the church living inside of us. God is with us. So nothing is impossible for God. As we talked about last week, he dwells within our bodies, for we are his temple. We are his temple. So make room this season for Jesus in your heart this Advent season. Be in his word. Hunger and thirst for righteousness every day of your life. It's been said that facts are like a recipe. Truth is a meal. Friends, you don't eat the cookbook, but you eat the meal. Truth is in God's word. So digest the truth, and it will change your life forever. God's word is truth. Jesus is the truth. Jesus said, I am the way, and I am the truth, and I am the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. Trust in Jesus and his word. Trust in Jesus and his word, and he will change your life forever. Jesus cleans our hearts and gives us new ones. Gives us a new one. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. When you follow Jesus, you have a new heart. The old is past, the new has come. Amen. We all know that pigs love mud, right? I'm sure over here at the Rimmer Kazan, they have pigs or not, but you can take one of those pigs. You can take it, you can give it a nice bath. You can brush its teeth, you can brush its hair, you can put a nice bow on them. But what happens when you let that pig back outside? It goes right back into the dirt and into the mud. The church, what I'm saying is, scrubbing and cleaning the outside does no good. It doesn't change the inner nature. We all have a choice as human beings, and we can change our nature, but only in Christ, and only by his word and the Holy Spirit. When you allow him to change you. When you trust in Christ and serve and love him with your whole heart, you will be sanctified, purified, and made pure. As I was studying for the pets message this morning, I learned, and I didn't realize this, but on the Australian National Coat of Arms, there's a picture of two animals. You know, Benjamin Franklin wanted a turkey for our country. We have the eagle, which we're thankful for. But they have an emu. It's a big, large bird and a kangaroo on their coat of arms. The two very interesting characteristics about both of these animals is that they cannot go backwards. The emu, if he tries to go backwards because of the shape of his feet, will just fall down. And the kangaroo, because of his large tail, can't go backwards. He can only go forward. Church, when we follow Christ, when we're purified and sanctified in our hearts, when we walk with him every day, there's no turning back. Amen. As Christians, if we go back, we will fall down. But if we go forward and follow Christ, you'll never fall down. You'll never stumble. Because Christ is carrying us and lifting us. So never turn back. Never go back to the old self. Thirdly, Jesus' love is a steadfast love. Turn with me again to our scripture text today in Galatians 4, verses 4 through 7. Galatians 4, 4 through 7. Listen as I read. The Bible says, but when the fullness of time had come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, in order to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as children. And because you are children, God has sent the Spirit of his son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a child. And if a child, then also an heir through God. I have to say, I think this has probably become one of my favorite verses in the Bible, studying it this week. I prepared for this message, thinking about the verse, God's steadfast love and what he did. When it says in the fullness of time, in the fullness of time, God sent his son. Think about this. God, a God who's always been, always existed, an eternal, everlasting God. He lives outside of time as we know it, and as we understand it. But this God that we love and serve entered time. He entered time and space, came to this earth as one of us. Our God was eternal. He had no beginning, no end, the Alpha and the Omega. Chose the perfect place and the perfect time to come to this earth to save you and me, to redeem us, to redeem you and me. What does that tell you when you read that? That you're loved, that you're valuable, and that you're worth more than all the wealth in this world in the eyes of Jesus. That he redeemed us and adopted us as his children, that we can call him Father. That is amazing. We can call the God of the universe Father, and that we're his children, adopted by him, adopted by Jesus, adopted by God, and that we are heirs, heirs to a throne. He was born at the right time. And we are heirs. Do you see it? As God's children, we have such an amazing inheritance that the King of Kings is who we call Father. We think of the royals over in England. They have their royalty, but we are royalty. We are children of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You're a child of the King. So read this verse, or these verses, every day, this week, if you will. Because this verse shows us that God does not make mistakes. That when we consider the fullness of time, you also were born at just the right time that God had in mind. And God had you in his mind from all eternity. You're here today because of God's perfect timing. Amen? And all we need to do, all you and I need to do is step out in faith and follow him. For where he leads, you will follow. Amen? Church, the Apostle Paul painted an amazing picture of the steadfast love of Jesus here in these verses. Church, the fullness of time that Paul's referring to, again, was the day that Jesus was born. It was the day that the prophet Isaiah spoke of in Isaiah 7:14. It says, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Look, the young woman is with child and shall bear a son and shall name him Emmanuel. Emmanuel meaning God with us. It's that day that God had in his heart from everlasting to everlasting. If God had a refrigerator in heaven, which he might, I don't know. If he had a refrigerator, many of us do, or a wall, he'd have a calendar on it, and on that wall, from all eternity, he had that day marked with this big star on it. The day that he would come to earth. Emmanuel, God with us. The perfect day, the perfect time, in the fullness of time. To be the perfect sacrifice. So as we close, just remember, God is faithful. He's always faithful. He is steadfast. He came to redeem us, every single one of us, every one of us that was born under the law. As the Bible says in Romans 3:23, that we have all sinned. Church, we've all broken the law of God. And the penalty for that sin is death. So if Jesus did not come that day in that fullness of time to die on the cross to redeem us, we would have no hope. Do you know, and I learned this, that in Paul's day there were over 60 million slaves in the Roman Empire. And if someone bought a slave, they had the choice to set them free or to keep them and use them as slaves. Church, here's the good news. The good news of Jesus' steadfast love. Jesus loves you so much that he came and endured death on a cross on our behalf. And he rose again, and by doing so, defeated death and sin. With his own blood, he purchased us out of bondage of sin into a life of freedom. Freedom for all who call upon his name. That the name of Jesus, Galatians 5:1 says, "For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not ever again submit to a yoke of slavery." In another verse, the Bible says, Ephesians 3:17, that the love of Christ, the steadfast love of Christ, surpasses all knowledge. Surpasses all knowledge. Can we comprehend that kind of love? Church, never forget this. And may this be an encouragement to you today, that no matter what you're going through, that Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you, and he is always with you. We can never fully comprehend his great love for us. Again, it's my prayer this Advent season that we all fully grasp the true reason for this season. There's no greater gift to receive in this world than the gift of Christ. It's the gift that cost God everything, but he offers it to each one of us freely. All we need to do is open our hearts and accept it. If there's anyone here that does not know the Lord, who would like to accept this free gift that Jesus offers, the gift of eternal life, please see me after the service, and I'd love to pray with you. If you're here and just need to be in prayer, I'd like to pray with you also, if you have a need. So may we all draw close to the Lord this Advent season, ahead, looking forward to that day when he returns, as he promised. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies are new every morning, and they never come to an end. Every morning, they are new. Great is his faithfulness. Please prepare your hearts now as we